Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you have had a fantastic Wednesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is, why is Scarlett Johansson in the news again? And spoiler alert, it's because people are really pissed off. It was recently announced that Scarlett Johansson will play Dante Tex Gill in the new movie Rub and Tug. And the reason this was such a big deal for a good number of people is that Dante Tex Gill was actually a trans man, considered a notorious figure from the 70s and 80s who ran a number of mafia-protected massage parlors in the city. Turned out those were fronts for prostitution. But of course, one of the main reasons people were angry here is people were saying this was another example of erasure. And the general idea around erasure and the examples that we see in Hollywood is when you have a character who is supposed to be from a marginalized group not being played by a person from that marginalized group, but someone else outside of that. So here we see a trans man being played by a straight white woman. Specifically, that woman is an actress coming from another controversy that is somewhat similar, that being the whitewashing controversy that she faced with The Ghost in the Shell. And actually, this new movie, Rub and Tug, is being directed by the same person who directed that, Rupert Sanders. And also something that most likely rubs salt in the wounds for those that are angry around this situation, I mean, you just look to the articles. Variety, The Hollywood Reporter, Deadline, who said that they had the exclusive, all referred to Gill as a woman who dressed like a man. And while the misgendering situation is something that is important to the trans community at large, it was also something incredibly important to Gill, right? So something incredibly important to the story of this person that a movie is being made about. In Gill's obituary, he was described as the woman who prefers to be known as a man. Later adding, insisted she was a man who wanted to be known as Mr. Gill. But at this point in the story, there wasn't a ton known. There was also the question of, well, how would Scarlett Johansson respond? But then we got a response from ScarJo via her rep about the backlash, who said, tell them they can be directed to Jeffrey Tambor, Jared Leto, and Felicity Huffman's reps for comment. And as you might imagine, that response of kind of just pointing to three non-trans actors who had trans roles wasn't received fantastically from the people that were already angry. And that's because, one, the statement appears to confirm that the story will depict Gill as a trans man, and two, considering how dismissive, deflective, seemingly harsh that statement was, it appears that she is not concerned about the trans community's response to this. Also, a thing to consider about a few of the people that she just mentioned, Jared Leto, who of course won the Academy Award for starring in a movie as a trans person in Dallas Buyers Club, he has said he would probably pass on the role if he were offered it today. Jeffrey Tambor, when he accepted his Emmy in 2016, said, I would not be unhappy were I the last cisgender male to play a female transgender on television. And as far as where I personally land on this, my personal takeaway from it, at the beginning of this story, just the general idea that Scarlett Johansson would play a trans man, I personally had no issue with it because, and I know that I'm gonna get some shit because people are gonna say that I'm dead naming, but Gill was born Lois Jean Gill, and if you're going to properly tell the story of someone who transitions, it feels like, at least to me, there might be a valid defense there. And that's in addition to, I think, kind of the general environment or mindset with acting, as you have actors and actresses where it's their job to be something they're not. But then she hits back with that reported response, and it's hard to not have a knee-jerk, fuck you reaction. I mean, what kind of response is that? Here, I'll help you. I'll do your PR for you. I'd like to apologize for that last statement. My email was hacked. That is not what Scarlett Johansson said. Scarlett wanted people to know that she's seen, she's receptive, and appreciates everyone's concern. And really what she hopes to do here is to take a fantastically complex and rich story about one person's journey, of not only one person's experience, but one that extends to an entire community, and use this position that she is so incredibly thankful and privileged to have to open the door for so many more of those stories and so many more of those people. Now, of course, keep in mind that that response would still fall short, but it is better than the sit on it and spin response that everyone else received. Actually, sit on it and spin would have been a better response than what they threw out there, because at least a few people might enjoy this one. But with all of that said, I do want to pass the question off to you. What is your takeaway from this story? And I feel like there's two main points here. One, the general casting of Scarlett Johansson for this role. And then two, what do you think about her response to the criticism and backlash? But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today. And today in Awesome, brought to you by BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And BetterHelp, if you do not know, is the fantastic place where you can get affordable private online counseling. You get access to licensed, trained, experienced, accredited psychologists, marriage and family therapists, clinical social workers, and board licensed professional counselors. And actually, on a personal note, they're not just a sponsor. They are a service I love, I use, and I am incredibly thankful for. I'd always kind of made excuses like I don't have the time now, or in the past, I couldn't afford it. But just having this available, whether it be from a computer or the app, it's just great. And actually, if it sounds interesting to you, you want to try it out, all you got to do is just go to betterhelp.com/DeFranco. And the first bit of awesome is actually some in-community stuff. One, if you're a member of DeFranco Elite, go there today. We posted a very special video. But also two, if you're not a part of DeFranco Elite, you're still interested in that stuff. As of tomorrow, on Thursdays, on youtube.com/PhillyD, the second channel, even though we're still actively developing it, we are going to start posting that content one time a week. We'll also have some more around the corner. Then we got a trailer for The Immortal. We got the Honest Game trailer for The Crew. We had a pyrotechnics pro explaining the art of a massive fireworks show. Then we had the fantastic Electric Donkey giving the people more of what they want.
Waluigi Tennis.
Then we had Dude Perfect giving us Ping Pong Trick Shots number 4. Then we had Seeker giving us a video on how stress rewires your brain and what you can do about it. And of course, if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about possibly the sexiest piece of news today, and that is, it is a story that involves some PCP. No, not the drug, you junkie. I'm talking about a political crisis in Poland. Also, I want it to be known, I don't care if you thought that was lame. That was for me. But the situation in Poland is wild, and I do want to talk about it. And so what we're looking at today is a 2017 Polish law just went into effect today that would force Supreme Court justices to retire at 65. And this move has been seen as incredibly controversial. And one of the first reasons is because it would effectively fire 27 of the current 72 Supreme Court justices. And it allows the government to replace all of them with their own hand-picked judges, and it's widely considered unconstitutional. And that's why thousands have come out to protest this, including the first president of the Supreme Court. Secondly, the government will also be making a disciplinary chamber that grants the government the authority to reopen cases against judges from the past 20 years. And finally, and your brain may have already been there, it is being seen as a huge power grab by the ruling Law and Justice Party. And in fact, just one in a series of power grabs since 2015. So there's a criticism, but as far as what the president and his party are saying, as far as the reasoning, according to them, the law will get rid of corrupt and ineffective judges that, quote, stop the popular will. In fact, some members of the party just flat out calling the judges unreconstructed communists and obstructionists. And so essentially they're saying this is just kind of a buckling down of something that already existed. But on that note, critics have pointed out that certain leadership in the Law and Justice Party had ties in the Communist Party. In fact, the head of the Law and Justice Party was allowed to study law in Communist Poland. But that also brings us to a very specific issue and why people are saying this is a constitutional crisis. One of the 27 Supreme Court justices that was just retired is specifically the president of the Supreme Court. And while you have the president and the ruling party pointing to Article 180 of the Constitution there, saying a statute shall establish an age limit beyond which a judge shall proceed to retirement. But at the same time, you have opponents saying, well, Article 183 of the Constitution contradicts that. It's stating the first president of the Supreme Court shall be appointed by the president of the Republic for a 6-year term of office from amongst candidates proposed by the General Assembly of the judges of the Supreme Court. So the issue at hand is the Constitution says both, yes, there are age limits where a judge can no longer work, but it also specifically states that for this specific position, 6 years is mandated. And so you have many arguing that there is a conflict there, that the 6 years must be finished, and because they change the ages, it doesn't all of a sudden undo 183. And the reason this is a big issue is it is the first time it has ever come up. And last night in Warsaw, that president of the Supreme Court said, I have no intention of resigning since my term of office is 6 years. Additionally, 63 other Supreme Court judges have voted saying that she should be able to finish her 6 years. And then also on top of that, she has a very important Polish figure on her side. Lech Wałęsa. He led the Solidarity Movement that threw off communist rule. He was also president of Poland from 1990 to 1995. He has also made it clear that if the president of Poland does not back down, that he'd lead a massive civil disobedience campaign against the government. Now, in addition to that, something that I think is important to hit on is the idea that this is just one in a series of power grabs. Because I think some could effectively argue, is it really a power grab if you're setting just a universal age limit? Sure, previous generations may lean heavier one way, but there is one key piece of information that I've held on till this moment that makes it so incredibly obvious that it is a power grab. According to the law, judges cannot stay on past the age of 65 unless, what? Unless they send a petition to the current president of Poland and he approves it. And in fact, remember the first president of the Supreme Court who was protesting? She is of course 65 and is so retired and has been replaced by a 66-year-old man. And in addition to this current situation, we see other things from the Law and Justice Party. They've removed 5 justices that were appointed to the Constitutional Tribunal that decides whether laws are constitutional or not. They also happen to be appointed by the previous government. And what's crazy with this story is that the CT itself ruled that 2 of the 5 justices were improperly appointed, but then the Law and Justice Party argued that all 5 needed to be removed. And so then that tribunal ruled that the president of Poland could not do that, that he had to appoint the 3 that were properly put in place by the former government. And in fact, every time the tribunal rules that laws that constrict its power are unconstitutional, the government, which is run by the Law and Justice Party right now, refuses to publish those rulings, which is required for them to go into effect. And so the government has been able to effectively ignore the Constitutional Tribunal. And there are several other examples, but something that really stands out, you have the head of the Law and Justice Party. He has said that no law passed by legislation can be unconstitutional since the legislation is the will of the people. And I will say that that is a
pretty interesting argument because it's the people want what the people want. If they put us in power, we can do whatever.
But I think it's very easy to argue that the point of most constitutions is to protect against the tyranny of the majority. And so you have this situation in Poland where you have people fearing that this is a move to authoritarianism, whereas the president of Poland has actually argued that this is a deepening of democracy, which I think is something you can effectively argue, except you have something in place that has an age limit. But then based off of presidential preference, some of those people then do not have to follow the rules and go away.
On the outside looking in, that appears pretty obvious.
And that's also why we've seen the European Union taking measures towards reprimanding Poland. On July 2nd, the EU initiated the infringement procedure. That could ultimately lead to the European Court of Justice's ruling the removal of Polish judges unconstitutional. But really, the president of Poland could just ignore that ruling. But in addition to that, there would also be the nuclear option in invoking Article 7. That would remove the voting rights of Poland in the European Union. But that's incredibly unlikely since they would need a unanimous vote of the other 27 nations in the EU. It's believed that Italy, Hungary, and Austria would not vote for this measure. And so as far as what happens next here, it appears that the change is probably going to have to come from within Poland, which still may not be likely because while there are people out in the streets protesting, currently the Law and Justice Party is still overall widely popular. Now there is the potential for change because local elections are coming up in a few months. It'll be the first real test to see if this decision is enough to make people switch. And there's also the question of will this drive more people to vote because currently 40% of Poles do not vote. But ultimately, like many situations like this, we're just gonna have to wait to see what happens next. Will the protests grow or slow down? Will the ruling party put things into play that make it harder for the opposition to run or to vote? It'll be very interesting to see. But the question I do want to pass off to you, do you see the moves that we talk about today as manipulation, takeover, power plays? Or do you see this as a country evolving? That just because things have been, that they don't always have to be. Are we seeing a breaking up of the framework to defend against tyranny, or are we seeing the changing of something that is old and doesn't make sense? I ask that question because it makes this story much larger than just Poland. Then, and this actually connects to the story, I want to wish my fellow Americans a happy 4th of July. Wishing you a happy Independence Day, 242 years as a country. But on this July 4th, we're seeing something pretty interesting. A new Gallup poll found that for the first time in their 18-year history of recording all of these polls, less than a majority of Americans say that they are extremely proud to be American, down from 51% last year to 47% this year. And as far as how the other levels break down, 25% say they are very proud, 16% say they are moderately proud, and then 7% only a little, and 3% not at all. And as far as where we see the biggest changes, that's where it's really interesting. For 2017 to 2018, for Democrats saying extremely proud to be an American, they went from 43% to 32%. With independents, you saw a smaller shift, 48% to 42%. And with Republicans, they actually went from 72% to 74%. Then as far as sex, over the past year, men stayed the same, but women dropped 7%. White people dropped 1%, whereas non-white dropped 11%. 18 to 29 dropped 10%. 30 to 49 dropped 9%. 50 to 64 actually jumped up 6%. But then 65 and older dropped 2%. And finally, college graduates dropped 8%, whereas non-college graduates dropped 2%. And it's all really interesting to me. And a question I want to pass out to fellow Americans. Where do you think you would specifically land? Not at all, little, moderate, very, extreme? And for you personally, how connected is your answer to the president, our Congress, what we're doing internationally versus domestically? Or for you, is that more connected to kind of personal freedoms, like the ability for me to say whatever I want as long as I'm not saying, you know, attack somebody? That we can vote in free and fair elections, although the Electoral College is a lot of bullshit in my opinion. Maybe it ends up even being a little disconnected from what the country is doing in the now because it's always about the potential future in your mind. I don't know, it's something that I'm thinking about having seen those numbers because I would describe myself as someone that is extremely proud to be an American. I think that's more connected to the idea of America and then the always possible potential in the country. I don't know, it's got me thinking and that's why I'd love to hear from you. Although I do kind of want to tag on something to the end of this story. I did notice that there was something that united Americans that normally would not stand side by side, and that was apparently a number of Americans don't know how to spell Independence Day or just autofill hashtag. This including the likes of Melania Trump, who then later deleted and fixed it. State of New Jersey also spelled it wrong, but also as of recording this video, they have not fixed it. US Air Force even got it wrong. And in fact, so many people verified and not spelled it incorrectly that it began trending in the United States. I, like a fool, saw the hashtag and was like, oh, is there like a meme where it's like you dance for independent? No, okay, everyone just can't spell. Hey, the most important thing is that together,
as Americans, we couldn't spell correctly. The real lesson? I don't think that's the lesson there. Anyway, that's that. And that's where we're gonna end today's show. And of course, remember, this is the PDS. It is not just a show, it is a conversation. So whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, remember, if you like this video, you like the way that I try to cover the news, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button, ring the bell for notifications. And actually, if you did miss the last Philip DeFranco show, you wanna catch up, you can click or tap right there to watch that. Or if you need something lighter, you can watch today's brand new behind the scenes vlog right here. So that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.